So for lesser folk, I remind them. And I say, so what do you want? What do you want from the talk? And as part of that question, there's a relationship that one has with certain things where you're never quite sure whether you are the audience or the spectator. Cattle, in my case particularly, I always prefer the barbed wire between me and them. And they have an extraordinary way of turning from the observed to the observer. Sheep, on the other hand, they know in better. But you'll notice that what sheep do is make extremely good paths. And I'm very interested in paths. I mean, I think this show is about paths in a way. I'm interested in what we do collaboratively without knowing that we do it. I'm interested in why the corner of the door ends up with a kind of mark for everybody. It's the boot. Which is why, maybe that's a very English point of view, but it's why there's a certain kind of modernism that I can't take seriously. There's a sort of limit to the way I can take white pen seriously, because I know what's going to happen to white pen. It's not an argument for painting it from brown, but it's the world ends up with its finger marks. This particular set of finger marks, this path, has the kind of resonance that I really like. It's some people finding a quick route through a hedge, and it's about 200 yards from the entrance to the Channel Tunnel. So it's a kind of amateur effort. But of course, we all make paths, but there's somebody who always has to improve it. That's what DAAD is all about. Now I wonder how you can make a better path. So, of course, I'm not so churlish as to say, the world should stay with paths, and what I'm really interested in is this. Now, it's a Frenchman making steps. And I would say that because he made the steps himself, they're incredibly steppy. Because he didn't do it so that I would take a photograph and then come here and talk about the steps. But they have a kind of desire to get up. What would it be? Du bas en haut. Anyway, I think one of the things about being a student is that things happen that are beyond your control, which stay with you forever, and it's different for different people. I mean, we're all stuck in history and it's rolling along and everything has its consequences and we don't really understand what they are, but they're affected by it in some way, and afterwards we might even wake up to certain things. And I suppose that, the cliche for when I was a student would be to say, well, it was the time of the Vietnam War, and that's could be a quite crucial discussion. But then there's another thing that happened, which maybe has had a kind of bigger and more penetrating consequence, which was Men on the Moon. And I can remember the equivalent of Mark Cousins saying, it's a purely military exercise. And I was about 19, and I thought, how could he be so cynical? Of course it's not military. It's exciting. Climbing Everest, it's going up the Orinoco, and 25 years later I feel very stupid, and it's an obvious example of a piece of use of power. Anyway, the consequences of going to the moon are absolutely infinite, I think. I mean, it's the way that we're living now is directly connected to the whole of that kind of energy. But I have to admit that I have a sort of strong medieval streak, so I tend to prefer it down here. And I've already said enough things that are a bit sardonic. I mean, I do think the world is a lot more like this than that. And, you know, however much time you spend on the internet, when you go outside the door, you're still spending dog shit. Don't go away. And I think what I like about architecture is that it's really sort of founded in mind. You know, procedures for making a building, you know, however technical they may be, are still really trying to resist wetness and heat. And they're usually founded in wetness because the land is wet. And I sort of enjoy that. And I think I prefer a broken paving stone to one that looks as if it's never going to break. Now, I would say that about, I don't know, 60% of you are not English, not indigenous to this country. But I am. And if you like, I've left it too long now, I have to live here. I don't know what I can do in order not to. And I think it is a pretty bizarre culture. I showed these two slides to German students a year ago, and they didn't understand them at all. Simply, they didn't know what D-Day was. They didn't know what the relationship of D-Day was to Park and Rhine. And of course, nor do I. But the point I was trying to make was that this is the culture I live in. It is the culture where tooling along the M3 and suddenly sort of D-Day, Park and Rhine. And you know, this coming weekend it's going to say a lot more to stuff. And I think it's an incredibly deep provisional culture. It's a culture that is, you know, we must use more sellotape than any other bird actor. It's a totally modifying culture. And full of people who don't fully understand the consequences of their actions, but we sort of love them for it. I mean, I would never go to this man. So, supposedly, I'm not a conceptual photographer, I'm a sculptor. And there's a whole way in which that's often mediated. You know, the picture on the left is a sort of calculated colour supplement in the picture. I mean, I like tools very much. I know quite a lot about them. I'm interested in their, I suppose, if you like, their etymology. How a tool turned from one tool to another, and so on. And I've always, that's somewhere up there, there's a screwdriver that my dad gave me when I was 7. I have to say, I'm incredibly disorganized, and that's real freak shot. There's no way the studio looks like that for very long. But I offer it because it's a kind of, I think it's good to mistrust slide tools. You know, they're linear, they don't have any nervous breakdowns in them. They just go from the beginning to the end and they look perfect. And of course it's a crap. I think it's worth being mistrusted for. However, I would not wish to say that, you know, the decorative acts of presentation, it's a French greengrocer, which, you know, were I to tell the French greengrocer how wonderfully he put out his ornament, you know, he'd probably punch me on the nose and say, pretentious prat. But I like that, you know. And we all do our hair. You know. We all arrange things. And we give value to things. So, you know, by and large, bad picture on the left, you know, bird shit, we don't like that. That's not what's off. But if you leave the bird shit there for long enough, it'll turn into a spider line. Pay to see it, so not fixed, absolutely fixed state. I mean, the kind of values that I am interested in are, I suppose, sort of fetishistic. They're the failing to empty the child's trouser pockets before the jeans go in the washing machine, and the what's happened to my lighter conversation, and then. So we're not allowed to. It doesn't work. So so what's the point? I've always liked that it's my life. And those values that everybody, they don't go away, everybody has, as a sort of, well, bare fetishism. I mean, that's the content of an 11-year-old's book. And it's all value to him. But I'm afraid that I'm also devoted to what you might describe as the accidental rhetoric of the street, those things where maybe the metaphor isn't intended. And it seems to me that it's perhaps just commercially unwise not to take the sign down before you destroy the inside of this failed enterprise in the bargain. I mean, this was up for weeks with all this fast and stuff pouring, it's only about a year ago, pouring down towards the front door with Royal Britain on the market. But, you know, there are other categories, because I don't believe that that's based purely in being short of a few bottles. I think that's pretty deliberate. I mean, if you know my relationship with the Czech part or the Slovak part, I think that's kind of...
Where was that picture?
Weeks ago.
Good.
And I sort of like it in local because of its cruelty. And I have collections of all sorts of things, but I wouldn't describe myself really. That's worse than being a collector, I'm an acquirer. Which means I suddenly realise that I have got a lot of something. I don't set out to do it. And I think it's actually the more interesting activity, but it's also the worst activity to live with, because at least the collector is somebody who makes a decision, makes categories, goes for it. But on the whole, I don't, you know, I have a few friends who are graphists, you know, and they have some view of the world which is kind of fixed or star, you know. Either you go and you collect all these bloody tin toys or only black and white pottery. I can't do it. So, sort of things I have collections of are shopping lists, people's attempts to make maps for other people whilst talking over them. But the voice has since gone, so you find them lying around the street. I mean, if you know that part of the Caledonian Road, it is very easy to get lost there. And maybe it's a very expressive way of saying that's what it's like when you get to the part of the Caledonian Road. And I suppose in a completely different category, you know, the child in Geneva who draws a house on the wall and it looks exactly like every other house that children draw, but, you know, Geneva houses don't look like that. But it's a sort of stock thing. So the way what I'm really sort of pushing at is all those things which are just at the edge of knowledge, which we could say what they were, but truth is, we don't know much about them. I mean, I would not know that steer was from the Will Rogers branch, but somebody does. I mean, somebody knows what all of these brands mean. And I think there's been a kind of culture which glamorizes art, made art into a sort of branch of the fashion business, which is probably all right in New York, because New York's a bit like. But I think it's a bit of a disaster in England, because the one thing you can say about England is it's not glamorous. And it's lots and lots of things, but I don't think it's glamorous. And I think it's too confused to be glamorous. So if something starts to get glamorous, it always has to be kind of manhandled in some way. So I offer you that as a kind of, that's actually what putting up a show for me is like. It's the horror of arriving in some bloody basement, usually with two rather overdressed, usually women, telling you how wonderful their space is for private use and what a grateful space it is. It's nothing like the plans they sent you. Has the work got broken on the way? Does it even travel? You know, what would it look like? 1,000 miles away from the happy studio. Is somebody going to help you put it up who even knows which end of the drill you use, the pointed one. chilling fear. And I think that's much more what making shows is like than, if you like, the colour supplement version. And I think there's another thing in the art world, which is to kind of deny influence, or, you know, the art world requires a lot of reinventing of the wheel. It's got a fantastic, I don't know how it gets enough, an incredible ability to sort of go for collective amnesia and deny influence. Something happens, probably less than a generation before, so that somebody else gets the chance to reinvent it. And of course, one can be the beneficiary of that. It's sort of culturally not a very well thing. Perfect that Oldenburg should be sort of jumping up and down. I mean, they're horrible slides, but I think early Oldenburg is very, very important because it has a kind of European, it's in a strange space between European culture and American culture, and it has a kind of pathos. And he wrote very well, and he made things with an incredible vivacity. And he made wonderful remarks. He said when he made a lot of work in a shop, he could just call the store and sell everything in it. What he made was the stuff of retail. You know, he made clothes, and he even made prices and then sold the prices. And the prices are beautiful. 10 cents made kind of plaster. They're very gungy. And he said that when he was making that show, or making that work, he felt that just the Pollock was Jackson Pollock. He felt that Jackson Pollock was crouching in his pants. And if you look at that period of Oldenburg, you can kind of see what he meant. And even for him to have said something which has a kind of sexuality, I think that in the early work was a wonderful sexuality, which is perhaps now lost in these very kind of architectonic things, but not always, but sometimes. Anyway, you know, I used to tell students that sculpture was just a sort of branch of cake making, and they'd get terribly upset. If you watch somebody who's a sort of halfway decent patissier, you can see that the procedures are very similar, and you just use a bit of chemical change, things that are soft here. But, I mean, I'm sure this is true for everybody here, but the problem in a way that's contained in this show is that it isn't difficult to like Oldenburg, because Oldenburg is one of us. You know, he's highly educated, sophisticated, international, well-read, whatever. You know, Simon Rodier, who just turned up in LA, was a tile setter. And in the evenings, he used to go and make this stuff in his garden, rather like Prater Cheval in France. And when he'd done it, he just disappeared. He just bugged it off. And he obviously didn't see himself as a self-conscious artist, and he obviously did something before. So, and apparently he's still living in San Francisco. I mean, somebody did find him, but he has no interest in this thing that he made. So what I'm really saying is that, you know, I have a lot of interest in it, but I see that there's a kind of difficulty because my interest must be sort of patronizing. He seems to have liked tools as well. And then, you know, what I'm trying to suggest is that, you know, this isn't a sort of big sort of postmodern number. I think the funny thing is that you're not in control of what influences you. And I'm sure that is true for you as it is for what I do. That the most extraordinary propositions can seem interesting to you. And partly how you come to them is through ignorance. You know, when you don't know much about something you're interested in it, that's enough. You get interested. You don't have to know whether it's so-called good or bad or kitsch or high or low or whatever. So I'm sort of indicating some of the things that would kind of lie around at home. I mean, there's a photographer who I think the books are lurking in here somewhere, Walker Evans, who I think is a fantastically interesting photographer, partly because there's a feeling in the photographs that they're almost like making sculptures. They're a kind of view of how the world gets ordered, how things get arranged, how we attempt to aestheticize the world even without meaning to do it. And this particular picture, which is in the 30s, which is where most of his best pictures were made, is, I think, either grain or sand in wagons on a barge going under a bridge, under the Brooklyn Bridge. And I think there's a sort of dynamic about bridges anyway, which is fantastic. We have two systems of transport, which is a mistake of contradiction. You know, one goes underneath and one goes over the top, and you're usually in the opposite direction. And it's, I think it's typical that he would somehow know that or feel that. I also think there's a kind of rather primitive thing, which is if you're on the bridge, you just got to look over. It's like looking down the well. It's a sort of stop behavior. But what's beautiful about this picture is that there's footprints in the gravel. So there's a kind of double scale. And then, you know, it's a bit cheap, this kind of editing. But Donald Judd, who you see had such good taste, had a peace of mind. In fact, one of the things I think is important, well, I think a good thing to feel good about is that anything you make, you will see the next day anyway. So I spent quite a lot of time labouring to join buckets together. And I went to New York one summer, and my favourite hardware store, which is now probably the old fire, was closing down. And of course I went through the sort of statutory distress of, you know, oh, how could they change this area? When in fact, you know, we are the problem. I was already part of that chain. And so I went to the sale and I bought sort of three or four, it's an act of fascism, I went and bought three or four items and pulled them back in the plane. And one of them was this extraordinary double bucket, which is somehow is such an American idea, you know, that the bucket has a fixed dimension because your arm in relation to your leg has a fixed way of being. And somebody in the States managed to go saddlebag, bucket. And I don't know whether it carries more, but it's that kind of doishness that American industrial design and hardware, I would have to now say, have. Tipped off in the front row. And I think that the movement of industrial design, let's say out of Germany and this country at the end of the last century to the States and then to Japan, is incredibly interesting. I mean, I think I was explaining to one of my children at the weekend that I didn't think that the fibre tip pen could have been invented in a culture which hadn't had bamboo writing instruments, even though the method for making a fibre tip marker has obviously got nothing to do with sharpening up a bit of bamboo. But it's like that cultural sense. And you feel it in the 20s and 30s American hardware, you know, that kind of, it's got a kind of energy to it, which we had lost probably by about 1880. And I think, well, we can talk later about what the Germans are doing. So, the point of this talk is really to talk about procedure. And I don't want to tell you about every single piece of work I did, so I'm going to show the work quite quickly. What I've tried to do so far is to make a kind of texture of interest. It took me about 10 years after being a student to even remotely get my act together. And I think that was for very normal reasons that are never really discussed in school. They're a little bit of breakdown, a little bit of falling in love, a little bit of falling out of love, a lot of falling in love. Sheer laziness. The kind of incompetence of being in the world. And I think that there has been an atmosphere recently for fine art students, which is like making pop songs, you know, get your act together, you know, if you can hum that tune. assume by the time 22 and a half, full will be well. The predicament is that she might actually have to live for sort of 30, 40, 50 years. And then the problems get bigger. So, I mean, I'm sort of saying maybe I fucked about with tenants. I didn't, but I didn't get anything very conclusive. And these were the first things I did where I thought, ah, this might be what I want to do, or how I want to do it. And I think really what it was that they just got simple. I stopped worrying about making masterpieces, which was a kind of ethos that hovered over my period as a student. I mean, as an example of a procedure, I mean, it's quite common that I might think of something that I want to do and get excited about it and go to it. So I might, for instance, have a globe, get some brown paper, get some sisal, borrow some poster paint, get the lid off the record player, find two books to support it. This is the best etymology of which can I end up. That's the glossy picture. So, in a perfect dimension, get this up horizontal above the kitchen door, see how it works. The horror, of course, is 10 years later, two slides come together, and you think, well, this is much more interesting. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the same problem for making a building as it is for making a sculpture. I know I just gave you a nice caption for this, but there's a kind of energy in that. And assuming this is good competition gallery art, and then there's soft of the wall, passes in, nice tension. All of that. I'm ticking the margin, but it's the schoolmaster problem. And I'm not, this is real scenic art, so it feels like it's not my intended band. But I think that's a very difficult tension for everybody. And I'm sure, some of you probably draw on the back of a cigarette pack much better than you draw on a drawing board. And sooner or later, you've got to resolve it. So this simplicity really meant just letting things happen, letting the rock look as if it was going to fall over because the bag wouldn't support it, but letting the bag support it, apparently. Or making this look as if I just kind of did it while I was having a cup of coffee, when in fact it's like so dangerous. It's got to lift it. You have to do it in a dustbin and keep it together. But the object of the exercise is to make the work look light. So somebody wrote the other day something about my fans and those who are not my fans, but were not my fans, can't bear that procedure. I mean, they hate the idea of it looks so bloody, like I did as I was eating my breakfast. And of course, it isn't done on that. I came home one day and I found that my youngest son had explored the house with a hammer. And he found out that the bath is cast down with enamel on it, black bits. And the lavatory, which looks so similar, interestingly, it was different. True. And he checked out the only good piece of furniture we have and found that bent. So it was a kind of minor domestic crisis. But what I remember thinking afterwards, after I spat him, boiling oil over him. I remember thinking, well, actually, that's how you find out what the world is made of. And that's what's enjoyable about being young. Even you could say it's the enjoyment of discovering that it's very painful to leave your finger in a flame. But that's how you find out that the flame is hot. You don't find out that the flame is hot because you're shown, CD wrong. It's an experience. So I made a sort of I'm glamorizing it, but I made kind of a memorial to this process as a child, we had a kitchen table in our house. So I ruined the kitchen table. It's quite hard, I find it quite hard to put a nail through a formica table because I was properly brought up and told you couldn't do that. In a way, it's a kind of gesture to myself. It provoked my intention. And then there's a lot of work which is really just fueled by, I wanted to do this on the left for a long, long time, but I thought it was too stupid, too bloody obvious. You know, when I did it, everybody went, oh, why? I thought, oh, when I did that before? I mean, maybe 5 years, thinking, how intriguing that these two things have all this language that connects them. But then it probably eventually really provoked by discovering the word algebra is Arabic. It's Arabic for putting bones together. It is actually, you know, set, it's a medical term. And I thought, well, if one had been told that as a child, you know, you've done better with algebra because it makes the process much better. Tactile. And I suppose really my method of working, which isn't the method, but it's a kind of, it's working backwards, it's doing things the wrong way around. So it's kind of desiring this pipe, and then eventually, after months and months of desiring, going to steal it with some students. And it's an incredible pleasure possessing the desired object. And then altering all the chairs to fit it. So they've all kind of, it's a leg taken off. They've all just been made to behave, to do the pipe spinning. So the pipe just misses everything and goes past the floor. And I can tell you, joining two buckets together is really quite difficult. I mean, sometimes in a difficult audience, I think you just have to set which you're not. Sometimes I think one just has to say, well, it's very well made. And it is. What I think is quite upsetting sometimes for artists is that sort of incredibly blunt, and it must be the same for you, very kind of simple things which make something work are completely invisible to the big audience. Even, and in a way that's a kind of act, you think, well, that's rather wonderful, they don't see it. But if it wasn't there, it wouldn't work. But in fact, it is the act of joining that figure of eight together that actually makes that possible, because that's what makes the two brackets structurally sound. If you like, it's the third or the fourth side. Because before that, they tend to sort of flex against each other because you've got these two brunettes that are joined. And it's actually quite an exhilarating experience when this level goes in and the finished solid, the whole thing goes taut. So it actually contains a sort of a structural non sequitur because surfaces only work like that to a certain degree. I mean, I use this as a terrible site. I use a lot of things where I kind of invite you to know something and then make it quite obvious to you that you must be wrong. So there is a small part of an audience which will still say to me, how do you make the glass balance on the top of the ladder? Do people really have such an angle? Do they not know this floor, if you sat on it, can be quite cold? Do they really have such a limited experience of the world? But having said that, you know, I shouldn't be so cruel, because I like the fact that there's so much information which makes you want to read it one way. And it's only when you check it out that you can see that the glass is posted in the wall. It's not very much in there, so I'm probably not about that in the wall, but it's enough to set up that set of tensions. And I quite like, it's an experience you have first thing in the morning where you don't understand what the light's doing in the window or something. There's a moment where your perception is kind of inverted. And I've made possibly too many of these empty things. And I think probably what really drove them was the discovery that you could make something on, rather like you'd make a hat or a shoe or a glass, where all the action is on the outside and there's nothing on the inside. So these are all, they're all solvable, which means you can join very, very thin surfaces. You can even join things that are painted in paint, so you can join two colours together. But you end up with no, there's no making information on the inside, it's just space. So I mean that's an example of a grey tin cover with a horrible spot. That's a British green one. And that's actually, you know, I'm sure everybody says they're welded together and that you couldn't weld them together, you wouldn't catch fire or paint. But you can solve them together and they'll stay, you know, they'll become structure in one. And it is, you know, it's important to me that there would be a kind of debate about, oh, did I cut it off and glue it on? But I'd like to think that people thought that work had a kind of morality in it. Yes, the other two legs are hanging in there, the rest of it isn't there. And what does it feel like to be in there? You know, all of that's possible. I mean, some work is fueled by things, by really very simple things. I heard that in Spanish, the thought bubble or the speech bubble is a bocadillo, it's sandwich. And I thought it was wonderful that this physical object, which is used for representing speech or thought, could be called a sandwich. So I made a piece of work called the English Sandwich, which, I mean, this is quite high on the wall, so you see up into the hat, you see that space which normally you wouldn't see because it's on somebody's head. And then hung a mirror in this sort of restful manner at an angle above it. So it's a very difficult thing to photograph. So this is against the wall here, there's a chain in the back which lets it fall out. So you get a whole set of rather odd kind of cranial views of this. I suppose it's expanding in from my head. again, to do with procedure, I couldn't. You know, it's obvious that I'm not somebody delivering some shelves. I mean, I'm a posy arranger of shelves. But, I mean, the one way at least I can kind of boost myself is to then arrange these identically. So up to there, these are identical parts. What I quite like is that, I don't know whether many people see that, but I, you know, making the first part is easy, making the second part, you're doing these measurements, you know, what time would work out a jig for actually making a false loose pile. This was made in Italy, hence the elegant green shelves. And I put tins of Italian food in the surface. This is an aeroplane tub. But it's a sort of small horror that as I was soldering them in place, they all started cooking. And in fact, it still belongs to me, but I've always imagined, you know, there's a certain kind of collector or museum where you have to confess, you know, and then the conservation department would come and discuss endlessly what the future of the tin of tuna was. I had a show at a certain time last year, or maybe more than 2 years before, where I mean, really sort of by accident, I ended up making a kind of, it's a bit like a kind of tower in there, because these things are absolutely impossible to move, but I filled the whole one of the galleries with them and made them, to some extent, look as if they just sort of been delivered. And just enough room to kind of wander around. So there was something about the behaviour of people in there that was a little bit like what it's like to be a tourist. I mean, you make decisions about whether you take a left or a right and this one's on. They're essentially out. And you then meet different things. I mean, there were a lot of mirrors that were suspended from the top. So they were usually in quite odd positions. The scale was very varied. They moved a little bit, but not, I mean, because they were, the bottom edge was on the ground. They were a bit more, they were a bit like this, yes. But some of them were tiny. And there were some very obvious sort of interesting things, like a bell that wouldn't ring and a light bulb that wouldn't light up. But things that are kind of stock, maybe things that are sort of archetypes. I made a lot of, really quite a lot of things with tins. And, I mean, to give you an idea of what would sort of make me want to make another piece of work, might actually be just for that. You know, knowing that this would kind of go, and it's enough. I mean, but I wouldn't have made that if I hadn't made that. And the piece on the left was actually made in front of the television crew. I've always thought it should have been titled As Seen on TV. And it's a really very, very odd experience, because I think television is essentially sort of military media. They come in platoons. They have these very strong relationships, and everybody knows exactly what they're doing. And it's completely unlike what I do. And they have time all of their own. I found trying to conform to their time, trying to make this thing, real Blue Peter sculpture, was up nearly all night to try and get ready for 8 o'clock shoot. I suppose one of the things that most artists have is that they have habits that they don't know they have. I mean, when I made this piece with these chairs, the other piece with the chairs, miles away, never occurred to me. This was actually based on working in Copenhagen and discovering that the Danish are very reverential about their flag. They put it to bed dust. I mean, they're almost as serious about the flag as the Americans are, but it's much more intimate. Not sort of rolling up, tucking it up, and beating it out at dawn. And of course, it seemed very funny to me. British flag, I think, is actually a fabulous set of emblems. I mean, it's the best collision of its parts, but it's completely and utterly culturally ruined. So I don't want to hold on to see it fly. I mean, it's like football. So it was rather nice to be in a culture which took the flag seriously and it meant something. And I happened to find some Danish kitchen furniture, which was the colour of the Danish flag. But much better than that, I discovered that the little flag pole fitted the feet. But not nearly perfectly. And I think that, although it's a bit glib to say it, I mean, I wouldn't make the work if it hadn't been the case. It's that simple thing of discovering it just fitted on. It allowed this to be. The show was in a warehouse, which is apparently was demolished last month. And it was very kind of Wild West, you know, it was facial, so tap coat. And it just seemed to need something that was a bit wavy. So, I mean, I made it as much as anything to kind of just to make a noise outside. But I can tell you that the cubism that you get when you put a chair on its corner and spin. Fantastic. And when you've got a choice of four, then you've got four legs and even the backstraps to play with. And the spatial possibilities are absolutely wonderful. And having them stopped in space was special. I mean, that's very typical of me. I mean, that's my. I lived in Berlin last year and I had a big horizontal top. You know, the thing that the English can't read. gone slide.
You couldn't believe it could
slide from these distances because all our distances are up and down. And the luxury, of course, was being able to leave them flying around and not being in a massive way. So I picked my way to the kitchen for weeks. And because I was there on my own for most of the time. And enjoy the things I had to run without being shouted at by anybody else. This is a sort of memorial to Turin. I mean, around Turin is like, it's pretty like China. I mean, it's essentially people are still planting lettuces and asparagus. But there's an awful lot of sort of metal bashing going on as well. So it's got a very odd feeling of being quite early industrial revolution. Suddenly there's a truck will go past full of castings and tank crop to the field. And then the people will come back and they'll do a bit of gardening and a bit of work on land. The two things are actually quite mixed up. And I was working near there and I was quite mindful of something that David Smith did once in a town called Spoleto, where he worked in a foundry. And it was a very, you know, it's, if you read about it, it's David Smith.
We worked 18 hours a day, 18 hour days. It was tough. I was really Italian.
And of course, I'd like to do that, but I know I can't, you know, I'm too. I'm not tough like that. You know, I haven't got a smashed thumbnail like David Smith. And I can't. So I did something very different. Which was, I mean, he made some beautiful things with benches. Very surrealistic things, like the old foundry tools apparently travel across the surface of these steel benches and droop and fall down. And in fact, without them, there wouldn't be any Anthony Paris, and for sure, those are the most important David Smith who didn't come. Anyway, I made the. I very, very bad paperwork. If I sit at the desk, I'll just look out the window and read. So I made a piece of work that was like working in the field and looking out the window and wishing I'd go to the garden. I mean, I never, it's over literal to tell you. And I don't mean that that's what the work is about, but the fuel for making it came from those kind of sentiments. And during the Serpentine show, I was given the window of a very good bookshop, not as good as the Triangle, of course, but. bookshop called Ian Shipley on Charing Cross Road, and I tried to do something that was sort of faithful in the way that some of the things I said at the beginning of the talk. So I shoved in the window lots of books that I might easily have beside my bed, and I buried the car underneath the spiel. I hid Philip Guston around the back. I turned most of Henry Moore, I used to work for Henry Moore, and I turned all the Henry Moore books upside down and made them support the weighing machine, and then I put all my books on top of the weighing machine. Childish stuff. I don't think anybody, I think everybody thought the window was being arranged. I don't think anyone read what I did. But there were nice, you know, there were just things that books do where subjects, periods, points of view are in collision. This has always meant a lot to me. Alec Taylor is a real Brit in a tweed jacket. And I found out about him because one Sunday afternoon, I was lying in bed, I wasn't ill, and watching television, and suddenly I saw this man saying, "Absolutely atrocious, I can't believe it. I mean, it looks like it's been done with a yardbook." And it was so eccentric for television. I mean, this man was serious. And I didn't know what he was talking about. It transpired that he was talking about pargeting, which is a kind of plaster work that's done in East Anglia. And, you know, this man knew about pargeting because he was an architectural academic. And he always spoke like that, and he always spoke with an incredible enthusiasm. And somebody told me that if you didn't know anything about wiring these buildings the way they are, that that was very good. And what I like about it is that it's a sort of mixture of economics and materials. I mean, there's a chapter just called lead, and it's like how lead came into architecture and how it got used, and who could afford it, and so on. There's a bit I remember about, you know, England is full of these houses with the white house. And white houses are just relatively poor people wishing that they had Italian stuff there. So there was a period, a kind of Dallas period, where people raised that, put it back in the white paint, painted the house white, and that did something for stasis. So it's full of that kind of stuff, which a lot of you probably know about, but I didn't. And at that level, it's very good. Anyway, I am genuinely intrigued by what I suppose would be of anything that's vernacular but with a small b. So I think it's bizarre to live in a country which makes dry stone walls, because it seems to sort of sum up England really. Dry stone wall is guaranteed to fall down, and it's sort of built to fall down, and it's cycle built into them. So the whole of the Cotswolds, the whole of the other parts of England, are in this permanent state of coming and going. And it's like a sort of something that's just been understood for a long time. And even, you know, so that it can be quite complex, they can actually be semi-dressed, which, you know, suggests if you've got a few more gold than the guy who hasn't been dressed at all. This is in fact part of a wall which is 1 mile by 1 mile by 1 mile by 1 mile. It's a box of 4 miles of dry stone wall, and it is perpetually falling down and it's perpetually being put up. And it's like, as you go past it, you can just hear the till, you just hear money. You hear landowning money running. And I have to say, I really like it. It's troubling at all. I, you know, Gloucestershire belongs to about six people, and good luck to them. I upset a walker once very much, who was telling me how wonderful the landscape was, and I said, well, why do you suppose it's like this? She didn't know about it, but she tricked on it. And I said, because it belongs to six people who like shooting. And it's true. But that's not to say that I wouldn't want to talk at length about other kinds of landscape. I mean, it was extraordinary for me to be in Berlin where the wall had gone. And yet Berlin is full of the wall, because it's a, it was a, you know, there's something which is so definitively specific about this method of construction. And it's curious, I think, you know, that stone is good, brick is all right, and concrete is brilliant, not cool. And it contains all that sort of, it's a sort of nominalness. And this became one of those places in Berlin which I just, I'm going to Berlin in the morning, I'm actually going to see this wall, and I know this will be happening, I'll still be stuck at that angle, and there's a lot to do. And other things that, you know, it's impossible to be, it seems to me that Berlin makes everything useful for tourists. I mean, I never discovered whether this was politics or whether it was a helpful person. Nobody in Berlin at the time, but all over Berlin, there are these, at West Berlin, there's this graffiti which says best after Berlin, which some of this is scribbled in. It's like saying, we're not going to deliver your post to the east. And I never found out what it really meant. There was a kind of vague debate on the street about it, because it was a kind of resentful. Anyway, when I was there, this is one time, Stalinallee, which is now Frankfurt Avenue. Anyway, it gets changed, its name changes as often as the politics tend. I mean, it was just extraordinary to me to be in this huge, emblematic street, which could be in Beijing, maybe Budapest, or wherever, because that's that system, just as Caracas looks like Sydney, or Birmingham, or whatever. And then suddenly have Jesus Christ and Michael Jackson. That was his campaign poster. And to have the whole of the centre of the street filled with these posters. Anyway, what I did like about Berlin is that it is in its perpetual state of argument. I eventually have to say I prefer the kind of argument of London because I don't understand the argument. Just London is in a perpetual state of kind of grumping against itself. And it makes a kind of particular culture. Whereas Berlin, I felt, had a much more, had a set of orthodoxies. And I thought, some mornings I thought, I'll get up and I'll have 6 earrings today and I'll get a nice flat leather trousers. And I'm this kind of person. Or I'll get up this morning and I'll buy myself a suit. Felt much more as if there were specific boxes that I could fall into. I love this. On the subject of Anglo-Saxon, I mean, I love the idea that mafia can escape into any culture and retain meaning. It's sure every time I see this picture on the left, it looks so cute. And it's funny that something which is the way something is sort of innocent, but it can't escape. And that is still the standard way of, that's the standard bicycle for a chimney sweep in East Berlin. You can give these kind of accoutrements. But it's funny that it immediately turns into a postcard. It can't just be itself. And I suppose, you know, it's probably got about 2 years left to run. They will be postcards, not in the museum. And the guys who do it, I don't say anything else in German, my German's so bad, but even when they are coming into an apartment block, they draw this ladder and this symbolic sweep on the door and put a date. And then they go on, they run out the date. And I didn't know what it was, but I just, it was an incredibly beautiful signature. And I only saw it about 10 times, but in the first 4 times I thought, this is it. You know, the most intimate graffiti to be on the glass of a double apartment door. Anyway, these guys do that. And I suppose, you know, to try and explain when I'm pushing it, is, you know, why do things look, you know, why could this not be in? Why does it look like a Joseph Beuys? And why are those German troubles and spades? And there's just something about the way they're made, something about, you know, shoveling and shoveling and spading and spading. And I think that's very odd in cultures, that they're so speedily different. I don't need to eulogize all the derelict buildings in Berlin. It used to make me feel, I used to want to burst into tears and sort of whoop at the same time. I mean, to see something that is stopped after what was probably the last serious medieval impact that just hasn't really had anything done to it except someone sort of knocked up a kind of roof. And then the whole of this building is still full of buildings like that, which are all waiting for people like us to go and make a few bob lights out of it. What's going on? So my actual working method I suggested was quite messy. I mean, it's kind of DIY and find out how to do it as you go along. So that, you know, lots of effort to try and get these light bulbs to stay on the front of this clock. And in order to make a piece that looks like that, you know, my very own solid circuit in the back where there's a piece of galvanized and each wire has a little hole and there's a whole you know, there's a system for achieving that. And I mean, it's private information, but problem because you can't open the front of the clock anymore. So you have to set an alarm clock for the right moment to switch it on. So you have to see wherever it stopped last time and then catch it at that moment because you can't change the hands because there's too much stuff on the line. I reduced the chairs to nothing, and what I did was just turn them into their own seats. I'm still not sure that this was the right method to use, but I wanted to find some sort of way that just made them. They were sort of nowhere, and you couldn't sit on them anymore, but they retained something of. You could feel an awful lot of heat. I did a show and got so wonderfully called an alternative space called Kunstversen. And I decided that I would put a lot of china on the ceiling. I mean, as a measure of how naive I am, it didn't occur to me that the consequence of putting china on the ceiling would be that it's built in wood. So I ended up with a kind of Deutsche Wand with plates stuck on the top. But the building was so unstable that we weren't allowed to go into it without a hard hat. They were falling, they fell in an incredible way. But you know, the best thing about it was all the different kinds of language which were possible for supporting it. So all the stuff was kind of taken. That wasn't taken from the street because we had to find it. None of them could find it. It became incredibly complicated to just find trash that was good for its length. And this was really quite a big space. And, you know, something else that sort of I touched upon, I mean, there's a whole geometry in there. There's a whole geometry of contact, and you know, there's exactly the right place to put a piece of wood. It's one you can understand up here. If you're putting them up, you can really feel. And if you put the stick in the wrong place, everything starts shimmying and flying around. And I couldn't help. Thank you. mean, if you know much about sculpture, I mean, it's enjoyable to do something where inevitably you make other people's sculptures for no other reason than you're trying to get this stuff to stay up. You know, so my favourite period as an Ankara is probably about 1964, so I made two or three sort of 1964 as an Ankara. But they're not calculated, but inevitable. And I did a hell of a lot of washing up. And some days I would come in and it would all be on the kitchen floor, you know, geologically collapsed in the night. And just, you know, by way of saying, well, if you don't do one thing, you don't do the next thing. While I was there, I was sent a postcard from Cattle's Yard in Cambridge, which this man who Cattle's Yard belonged to was a man called Jimmy, and he was an extremely obsessive character. And if one of his plates broke, he would mend it very badly. But I loved that kind of, you know, don't let it lose the plate. And I think every, you know, even if you don't like a plate, it's a very important thing. It's a very, very resonant. So I'm ashamed to say that when I was invited to your show there, I bought the most unpleasant stuff, which I noticed, when it all comes together, it becomes incredibly aesthetic. There's only about three things that I can bear to eat off. I have probably eaten off about 20 of those plates because they're in those British caps. But I've brought all the portal stuff in Caledonian Rome and then broke it and then moved it together with them. Which I suppose is, again, as I've already said, there's a way in which I have to go forward two places and back three. So my son said, God, you know them really well. I mean, I got really, really good at putting them together. But I am ashamed to say that there's a black one, the black sources. So I used the right colour glue, but only for one. And on all the others, it shows up something terrible. And normally there's a brown koozie on the pen. So I have a jug on the side. Anyway, just to finish off, I mean, I think, you know, a lot of you are not really going to live here permanently, and you probably think what a very strange place England is. I mean, I'm a couple of years away from being 50. I think what's so strange is to live in a country which is permanently being sick. It's like the architect of building things has always been sick. You know, the 19th century is always like, there's a skip full of door frames and brass door handles. It's like, you know, you can never, never, never get away from the 19th century. I bet half the people in this room live in a 19th century building. It's not because you so desire to, it's because you don't have a choice. I live in London, and one morning I was waiting at the bus stop, and, you know, there was a silver stack that's always beside my bus stop. And this is really, you know, unfortunately it's early morning London, it's really worth analysis, because this is the 30s as it went into the 50s. This is Birmingham. This is what Japan knew about. It's an essay on the bicycle, the valor heater. Everything is kind of mostly pressed and very thin and painted once and rust, you know, and rusty. But it's what I grew up with. It's, you know, and it has a particular smell, a particular feel for me. I don't want it, I don't desire it, but I have to say I recognise it. Anyway, right next door to this man is a man who sells furniture, and he makes really the best arrangements in London. You get a kind of essay in all the different ways the tables might be every single day. It's never the same twice. These kind of compounds of objects. So, the reason I have not left London, I went to Bath. previous road. I think they're interesting. And recently I used some slave labour to make this piece of work, which quite typically I hadn't tried out before I did it at all. I had one book in the kitchen, same kitchen that the door was using, one book and one piece of wire. The man who runs the scanner said, well, you can try this out in the studio, of course. And I was shitting myself. I mean, I had not the foggiest, but I don't think you can probably build buildings in that way, but I think there's something very good about that compressed anxiety. It's an anxiety where, in fact, you go to things much better than when you've over-rehearsed them. I mean, this is a kind of quite clean set of optimistic modernist boxes. I mean, they don't get much chance because, of course, where are they? They're in the 19th century site. So they keep telling you where they are. And there's some stairs. This would have been a front space onto a street. So it actually gives you, there's some steps upstairs. So it gives you this chance to have two levels. So really, all I did was to use that. And I think I actually prefer things during than after. I mean, I like the making of something. I like actually doing it. This may be even sort of, I mean, it's my most favourite part of the show is going past this door, and there are these kind of books that look as if they got caught in some gigantic refrigerator. Here, so you know, yes, you need it. It's nice.